chapter 3, where we're going to begin looking at CSS, cascading style sheets. We're going to understand why they're a good thing, and they are a great thing. You're going to really enjoy them once you get the hang of them. The trick to remember is that you've just learned a new language called HTML, and now you're going to learn a whole other language. It's kind of like the difference to me would be like the difference between learning South American Spanish or Central American Spanish or Castilian Spanish. You have somewhat the same goal, somewhat the same style, and yet some things are very different. So get ready and take your time and follow the tutorial, watch the book closely, and you'll do fine. So, CSS is used to format the web pages that you've been creating with HTML, and it offers many advantages. Mostly, layout is the newest great thing about CSS 3. You have greater consistency on a website, not just on a web page, as this slide says, and you can easily modify code site-wide by just changing it in your style sheet, which gives you more flexible formatting. Here's the history of CSS. Pause it if you want to read it. And we're going to look at how to define a style rule. It's a combination of three parts, a selector, a property, and a value. Don't get too caught up in those words right now, but basically, we're going to use this to modify how something looks in HTML. So let's keep going so that I can actually give you examples of what this looks like. A style sheet is a collection of one or more style rules. Rules that tell how your page looks and how it's laid out. They can either be within the HTML document that you have created or in a separate document. We're going to start by defining color. There are 16 basic color names. They're probably in the back of your textbook, but they're easily Googleable. And then there's a more extensive list of color names in CSS 3, and you can see we can use either the color name, the hex code, or the RGB triplet to describe the color. Now, an inline style is a style rule that is embedded inside an HTML start tag. We're going to play with those a little bit, but ultimately it's just practice, because the whole point of CSS is that you're not using it inline. You're using it at the top of the document or in a separate document all by itself. But we're going to play with it just a little bit, and you're going to see how it's different from the HTML rules that you've been using. An embedded style sheet is a set of style rules contained between the style start tag and the closing style end tag in the head section of an HTML document. So, since it's in the head section, that means you're not going to be able to see that text on the page. Remember, the head of the HTML document is behind the scenes, and the body is what people see, except for the tags that modify it, that tell it how to look. So the syntax for that is we say bracket style type equals quotation text slash CSS close quotations every single time. Every single time, that's the same, unless we're going to link it to an external page. But for internal embedded style sheets, this is the syntax for that. And you can see in this example that H1 is a heading, and that we're going to say the font color is orange. Except in CSS you don't say font color, you say color. And we're going to say that it's aligned in the center. And then we're going to say for H2s, they're going to be green. And you see here in the page the result of those commands. Bam, that looks different, huh? That's because I applied a different style in PowerPoint to this PowerPoint presentation. And the way the PowerPoint works, or Word, is that you have a set of style sheets that tell the PowerPoint presentation how to look. HTML is the same way. With the changes to just the style sheet, it changes the entire presentation. You see, so we're looking at a completely differently styled PowerPoint presentation now because I changed the style sheet in PowerPoint. I didn't have to use HTML because with PowerPoint, it's a WYSIWYG user. user interface, and so I just selected a different theme. When you are using an external style sheet, now back to this. When you're using an external style sheet, you need to use the link element to link the external style sheet to the web pages. Instead of just having style at the top, it's a link to another page that has the styles on it. The style rules are added to that style sheet, whatever it is, and the last three, the extension on it is .css, and then link to the index page, which causes them to be applied. One style sheet can be linked to many web pages, which is ideally the way you go. And more than one style sheet can be linked to a web page. So here's what that looks like. Now remember, we already saw this little bit, this quotation mark text slash CSS. But this is what the link looks like. Link href equals. So it's not a href, as we linked in HTML. It's link href equals. And then the address, the page, is probably just not, there's probably not a path. It's just the page there on your in your same folder, unless you have a folder for style sheets because you have multiples, and then you would have maybe the path would be whatever you call it, style sheets slash style.css or whatever you want to call it. We say the relationship is, it's a style sheet. And we say the type equals text slash CSS. So here we see the link element. If we have an external style sheet, link href equals taxi underscore layout.css. You see, let me go back a bit and show you how that's different from how we had it before. This one was just style type. This is when it's embedded. Now, I know this is a bit confusing right now, but bear with me. You're going to have to work with this for it to take hold. But the style type embedded on the same HTML page that you're saving everything else with, this is the syntax in the head of your document. Style type equals text slash CSS. But if you have an external style sheet, which will affect multiple pages, then it looks like this. Link href equals in the name of that page, and then relationship equals style sheet, and then type equals text slash CSS. So in this case, we're going to do some things to this page. We're going to set the background color as orange here. We're going to make this heading white, and the background color here is chocolate, although it looks like orange here. So let's get on with that in Notepad++. Looking at page 139, we begin by opening, as it says on page 139, in our text editor, which is Notepad++, the files index underscore t3.htm, within our iMed1316 folder, within our tutorial 3 folder, within our tutorial folder, index underscore t3.htm, services, and I'm holding down the control key to select multiple pages, and Toronto. Open, and look, all three are open. We're going to save each of them without the T3, so file, save as, I'll just take out the T3 underscore, file, save as, again, removing the T3 underscore, and file, save as, again, removing the T3 underscore. So these are my documents, and I need to put in tutorial 3 and my name and the date. And then copy that to each of the documents. And then save all of them. File, save all, or Control Shift S. Now let's go back to the index page. Click the FAQ services and About Toronto links to view the corresponding web pages. Okay, so we're supposed to be looking at this in our browser. Hang on. So in Chrome, I can open a page by going Control-O, Alt-O, Shift-O. What is it? Well, it was Control-O, and I was just too impatient. And then index.htm. And this is what we're beginning with on this assignment. so we're supposed to click these and see what the pages look like. But fax services, that one worked. Oh, I didn't open this one and rename it. Okay. So anyway, this is what the pages look like. They're a bit boring. Back to Notepad++ and make sure I open that FAQ T3 also. And save as without the T3. And copy this. Now I've caught up with myself, haven't I? Okay. So, we turn the page. And we can turn to page 142 for the next tan box after reading about CSS, which I've already told you. And it says, to view in your web browser, open the extended colors HTM file from the tutorial 3 folder. Okay. Back here. Extended colors. Ah. So we have this list with all the colors. All the web safe colors for CSS. You know, even though you can see the color here, it's going to look different on different browsers. It's going to look different using a projector. It's going to look different on a handheld device. But this is kind of, you know, the best we can do with such a variety of technologies out there. So don't get too hurt if you want maroon and it looks burgundy, Aggies. Same thing for the colors. These are the same colors that you would use for that. And on page 143, it talks about understanding hex codes and RGB triplets for defining color. So we're going to dig in on page 144 to apply an inline style to our index.htm page. And remember what I told you, an inline style is really, we're just playing with it right now just to see an instant result. It says position the insertion point after the one in the H1 starter tag in the body. Here's the body. Here's the H1 starter tag. Insert a space, and then type the following, as shown in figure 3.5. Style equals color, colon, orange, semicolon, quotation mark. Now this is pretty much the syntax for CSS. You open it and close it with a quotation mark here for color, and this is where you're telling it what to do, and this is where you're telling it how to do it, and this is what you're talking about. I know that sounds kind of vague and generic, but the more specific terms are in the book, which you're supposed to be reading, and so I'm not going to use those same terms over and over and confuse you by not giving you different words to help you understand. Just remember that any style rule you apply has to be ending in a semicolon. That's all you need to know for now. So let's save that and go back to our index page and see what happens to our H1 file. Home is index. And look, I just pointed at my screen. You didn't see that, did you? Anyway, our H1 changed to the color of orange. It's kind of yellowish orange, but that's how that works. That inline style rule changed it. Now let's look at an embedded style sheet. An embedded style sheet is the set of rules I told you contained between the style start tag in the head. So we don't have that here yet. So we're going to create an embedded style sheet. We're going to go to this page and we're going to delete the one we just did. And just let that stay in H1. And then in the head section after the title tag, here's the head, here's the title. So after that, type style, type equals quotation mark text slash CSS, close quotation, close your bracket, and then enter tab. H1 tab curly brace, which is right next to the P on your keyboard. Enter tab color orange Notice when I hit return, it lines up for me. Text align, colon, center, semicolon, return, backspace, close my curly brace. Now do one for H2, backspace, enter, backspace, H2, tab, curly brace, enter, tab, color, semicolon, green. I mean color, colon, green, semicolon, and close the curly brace. Now I can promise you that I am not going to be that disciplined with these throughout as far as the tabbing and everything, but I can also promise you that you are going to be a happy camper if you will keep white space between your lines, between your commands. You don't have to have this return here. You could start your command here. You could do that. And you could finish it here. But if you line up your braces, it makes it easier for you to find things, to find what you're looking for when you have to go back and make changes. This is how I would typically have done it if I wasn't exactly following the steps in the book. So now it says save it. And what's going to happen? We're going to go to our index page, and we're going to see that although we already made that H1 color down here, even though we took it out, we put it back in up here in the embedded style sheet instead of the inline styles. And we said the color of the text is going to be orange. And this time it's going to be aligned in the center, which we had not said that before. And we're going to also see that the H2 text is going to be green. So let's look at that. And I have not refreshed the page yet. Goodness, this is slow. It's not slow. I messed it up. Can you guess how I messed it up? Look, this is what's showing up now. But it's there. View page source. See, it's all right there. What I did was I didn't close my style rule or my embedded style sheet. So I got to come down here and I've got to go like this. Close. Now it will work. Back to this. See, it hid everything that came after it. When you make that kind of mistake in the head, it'll hide everything. The whole page will be white. So here we see that our H2s turn green, our H1 is orange and centered. Now that's not, you know, we could have done that with HTML that you already learned in the first and second chapter. But the reason we do it in CSS is because we can make that happen on every one of these pages by only doing it once and not copying and pasting like we had to do with the Australia Koala page, but by having a separate style sheet that tells all of these pages what to do. We'll get there in just a moment. So in our text editor, it says open a new file. And so we're going to come up here and open a new file. And at the top, we're going to make a CSS comment, which is not like an HTML comment. Remember, an HTML comment is like this. We're not going to make it like that. This is a CSS comment. And so we're going to say here, classic taxi layout style sheet. Author, your name. And then we close that comment tag with a reverse, asterisk, slant. All right? And then we're supposed to save that, and we're going to have to give it a name. So let's come over here, go all the way up to all types, and it tells us to call this taxi_layout.css extension. And there we have it. Now we're going to use this page to do a couple more things, a couple of things before it does us any good. Right now, it's not going to affect our HTML pages at all. For several reasons. First of all, it's got no style declarations on it. It doesn't tell us anything about how anything's supposed to look. It just has a hidden comment here. Second of all, these pages aren't linked to it. They're going to have to be linked to it for it to work. So, on page 148, it tells us to define the background and text color for the heading elements. And whenever you do a style sheet can get incredibly long. And so it's really nice if you comment your sections so that you know which applies to what. So in this case, we're going to do a comment, heading styles, close the comment, and then give us some style, H1, background color, that's the way you say that, is going to be orange, semicolon, and the font, which is just the word color, oddly enough, it's going to be black. Finish both lines with a semicolon, close our curly brace, go down, get a little white space there so we can see what we're doing, and do an H2 command. Brace, return, background color for the H2 command, or the H2 lines, it's going to be chocolate, a standard web safe color, and the font is going to be white. And we're going to save that. And guess what? It's not going to change this one little bit because we haven't hooked them together yet. The book hadn't told us to, so that's where that goes. Now, what we are supposed to do is go back here to our index.htm page, and they want us to delete the embedded style sheet and restore the file to its pristine state. So we'll do that, save, and we'll see that this goes back to what it was. Now we're going to link the external style sheet on page 149 by returning to the index.html page. And we're going to, in the head section, after the title where we just deleted that style, we're going to type link href, which is how you do an external style sheet link, quotation equals quotation, and the name of our file that we're linking to is taxi_layout.css because that's what we named it, and what the relationship equals style sheet, and the type equals quotation text slash CSS close quotation slash close brackets. Save. Now this link, if properly typed, will cause our page to link to that little style sheet we just created and look different. So let's try, bam. I just refreshed it, and you can see where those styles are working on this page now. Now we're going to define the color for the paragraph and footer elements. So we go back to our, this is where we're going to make most of our changes now to the way our document looks, here in our external style sheet. So after the H2 style, we're going to type a comment code to say this is going to be the paragraph, how the paragraph looks. And you notice that with Notepad++, the color coding that we have with HTM is also very convenient for CSS. So we're going to say that a P paragraph, curly brace, is going to have a font color of saddle, brown, semicolon to end that one, and it's going to have a background color of pale goldenrod. Make sure you spell it right or it won't work. Pale goldenrod. Semicolon. Close my curly brace. And save it. And let's see what happens to our paragraph here. Oh, wow. So this is obviously a paragraph up here, and these are all paragraphs. And they've been changed. Now let's go back on page 151. And let's do the footer. I got a little carried away, wanted to look at it. So we're going to go here and make a comment footer. Actually still on page 150. And we're going to say the footer, there's the word for that. background color. Pale goldenrod. Close our curly braces. Save it. Now what happens? I think we're going to see something down here in our footer. Yes. Okay. So now that the headings, text, and footer styles are defined, the links are kind of scooted over. So we're going to change the style of the links by applying a style to the element that creates them, which is the A element. So back here in the taxi layout CSS file, let's tell it what the links are going to look like. First, a little comment to say this is going to be about the links. And then A, which we already know, that's the same as in HTML. A is a link, it's an anchor, curly brace, color, orange. Close our curly brace. And save it. And come back here. And we're looking at the links to see what happens. And you see they turned orange. On page 153, I'd like you to read where it says written communication, color, and culture, and how important colors are to different cultures. And then we're going to come back to our page, and we're going to change background color of the entire page. And so we're going to tell ourselves, when we look back at this 2 years from now and need to change it, here's the body. And the body is going to have background color of khaki. I'm going to close that, save it, go back to our document, and look at it. And we see that the entire background color is khaki. Page 155 tells us to return to the taxi layout CSS file in the text editor and edit the color for the background color property for the body selector to delete khaki and insert white, because I guess they decided they didn't like that. And then return. Now, here, let me tell you a little bit of a little design theory. One problem you would have if you kept this background color is this big white box that's your logo up here, or your banner. So if you have it white, then everything blends and it doesn't, you can't tell that. It just looks like the whole thing is that way. See how it blends around there? So that's one reason for that. Another thing we could have done is we could go into Photoshop, we could take this image and we could turn it into a GIF and give it a transparent background so that it lays on whatever color we have there. But that's a more complicated thing than we're going to do in this course. So we've finished section 1, and we're going to go on to section 2. I'm looking at the page and I'm seeing that that heading is still khaki. Maybe we were supposed to take that out. That heading, pale goldenrod. Let's look at that. Or that top of it. Oh, header. Header, header, header. Note that the headings, text, and footer styles are defined. Heading styles, H1, background color orange. Nope, not H1, H2. Header. H1, H2, paragraph. Well, let's see what's wrong with this then. Why is that white there? The header is right here. The paragraph was within the header. And we told paragraphs to be pale goldenrod right here. So that's why the background is that. And yet in the textbook, it's white. Well, if we have to go back and change that to make it match later, we will. The textbook has a lot of errors in it, I'm sorry to say. So, on page 156 and 157, we see visual overview of the stylizing the text using CSS. On page 158 and 159 is some very important theory for you to read about fonts. And this PowerPoint slide is not enough to tell you, so please pause this and read those pages. It talks about fonts and font families and how generic fonts are the safest to use. It also talks about sans serif and serif fonts and how those are the common web page design. What happens though if you use cursive or fantasy fonts is they render differently in different browsers. So you have to be careful with that. The safest thing to do is if you want to do a fancy font, make an image with that fancy font in it and then use that. Let me show you an example of what I'm talking about. Here's my page. I'm in the process of redoing it, so it won't look like this when you look at it probably. But notice up here this gorgeous font here. You can't get that just with one of the standard HTML fonts. This is an image. So I went into Photoshop. I grabbed this picture of a quill off the web somewhere. I made a white banner. I put a layer that was a font, this pretty font. I called it, typed in my brand name, changed font to something clean to come down here and put this in, layered my image on there, and then saved it as an image and saved it for a web safe display. So that's something you're not going to get in this class. Sorry. But there is a banner generator out there. There are plenty of them that you can use to create banners. I did this with Photoshop, but you can find a banner generator and use that to create a banner for your website. So now we're going to go back to here, and we're going to apply the font family property to the body, which means we're going to come back to the layout CSS page, and we've already said here's heading, paragraph, footer, links, body. We already have a body described, description started. So underneath this, before the curly brace, we're going to add the font family, which is Verdana, Geneva, Arial, Helvetica, sans serif. That's a really good place for you to make a typo, and probably won't make a big difference at this point, but later on it could. So it says save that, and then go back to our document and see what that does to it. Now, sans serif means without serifs, and serifs are the tiny little edges on the letters. You see, those are serifs. So we're going to, when I refresh this, those serifs are going to go away for the body. They're not going to go away up here because this is an image, and that's not text, that's an image. So watch what happens to this and everything except this when I hit F5. You see? The little edges went away. So this is a sans serif font because we told it to be. Now let's go back to this page, and we're going to set the font size. And so in the link, we're going to do it here. We're going to say we want all links to be the font size of 1.5 em, and that means it's going to be 1.5 times the standard font throughout the rest of the document. We come back here, which is described on page 161 and you need to read. We refresh that and you notice our links got bigger because they're 1.5 size what our standard normal font is. Back to here, and we're going to set the font size for the H1 and footer text. So we come up here to where the H1 is, and we change our font size, or we say that our font size for H1s are going to be 2.5. Now, why are we doing that? Our font is already bigger. Well, it is already bigger because we said it's an H1. And an H1 by definition is just, it's going to be different than the normal font. So in this case, we're going to say, but we want our fonts, our H1s to be exactly 2.5 EM. We're not satisfied with the browser saying what an H1 looks like. Then we're going to go down to the footer, and we're going to say we want our footer font to be smaller than everything else, smaller than the normal size. So it's just going to be 0.7 EM. So it's not going to be a whole 1 would be the same size. 0.7 is going to be smaller. So I'm going to zoom out a little bit so you can see what happens to both the footer and the H1 when I refresh. See, the footer got smaller and the H1 got bigger. On to page 164 to change the H1 text to all uppercase. Now, granted, we could simply come here and we could say type all uppercase letters, classic taxi. But you can also use the style sheet to make that happen. And you would do that if you had a document with many pages and all of your H1s were typed in sentence case or this kind of title case, and you wanted to change them all to all caps, then you would go to your style sheet, and we'd go back to our H1 heading, and we'd say the command for this is text transform. And we're going to say uppercase, semicolon, save, and let's see what happens now to our H1. There it is. Now, the letter spacing property and the word spacing properties are very handy in CSS, and that's called, letter spacing is known as kerning, and we're talking about the white space between the letters, okay? Well, here it's actually orange space, right? But we're talking about the space between the letters. And so we're going to add some space between the letters in the word in the classic taxi heading. So we come back here, and in our H1 on our taxi layout CSS page, we're going to add letter spacing and word spacing. Now, why, you ask, in the textbook, did they add letter spacing here and word spacing here? They're not going to tell you this in the textbook, I don't think, but typically you alphabetize these commands. So if you have a whole bunch of them, they're alphabetized. There are a few that you should put first when it comes to layout, but unless it tells you to put them first, then alphabetize them. So we're going to say letter spacing is 0.2 EM. No, is it? I can barely see. It's been a long day. Semicolon. And then here, after text transform, we say word spacing is 0.5 EM. Semicolon. Save. Come back here. And let's see what happens. We're talking about this is going to happen here in our H1, right? So let's see what happens. Oops. When I refresh. You see? So it spaced it out between the letters. And now we're going to do some text indenting. On page 167, we see the syntax for that. For the P selector, the paragraph selector, we're going to here's the problem. Look at this. Remember earlier when I said, what's wrong with this? Why is this still this color when it's white in the book? It's because we were supposed to, at some point, take this line out. There it is. Okay. So now it says text indent 3 EM. Semicolon. Control S. And let's look at what happens to our paragraphs now. Here are our paragraphs. Now, we took out this background color, right? And we indented the text. So let's see what happens when we refresh. Wow, lots of changes, huh? So we go on. On page 168, it talks about designing printer-friendly web pages. You need to check that out. And if you are still looking at the PowerPoint, this is about the font family property and the most common family style properties, and this is about the font size that I told you. EM is a relative unit to make whatever the normal size is, bigger or smaller. These are other ways that you can express font size in absolute units. These are the choices for text transform. You can capitalize like this, lowercase, text appears in all caps with uppercase, or none. You would use none if you had previous values stated. Here is where we did the spread heading, if you need to study that a bit more. Here's where we indented text. Here is where we look at line height, which is our next step. So here in the taxi layout file, we add the following CSS property to the P style rule, and that is line height 1.5 em semicolon, save, and let's see what that does to our paragraph. Here's a paragraph. We're going to look very closely at this paragraph and see what happens when we refresh. Okay, so we just got a little bit more space here, a little bit more white space there. Now, on page 170, it talks about the font shorthand property. So let's go back to the PowerPoint on that because it's really important. The font property is one of several CSS shorthand properties, and it's where you can put several things in a line, in a row, combine several things in a row. So here we have an example of the fonts listed. We have a font style, a font weight, a font size, and a font family. But we can use the shorthand style of writing CSS and putting them all on one line. Now notice, when we put them all on one line, we take out all these extra semicolons. There's a semicolon at the end of the line, but here instead of saying font style, font weight, font size, font family, we just say font colon. And we say italic, normal, 1.2 em, Arial Helvetica Sans Serif. So we still have our commas here where we would have had them here, but everything else is just a spacing goes between them. But they must be listed in the correct order, which makes it, you know, a little tougher. If you do it up here, it's not so important that it be in the correct order. As you can see, font family alphabetically does not come after font size. It would have been the first thing. But in this case, it must be in the order font style, font weight, font variant, font size, font family for it to work. Now, if you recall on page 145, when we created our embedded style sheet before we erased that and went to our external style sheet, we had typed in an H1 style that was a color of orange and a text-align center, which had caused our H1 here, before we had a background on it, to be orange and centered. We erased that because we were just playing with the embedded style sheet at that time. And I didn't much explain what text-align meant, but text-align is how we can line up our text, either left, flush with the left margin, flush with the right margin, centered horizontally, or justified so that the any row that wraps will go up to the right margin. Justification in text is not recommended. It's what you see in a newspaper, but it's been learned over the years that it's harder to read to have the irregular spacing. It's particularly harder to read for elderly people. As our eyes go, we certain things become harder and harder for us to distinguish. And so a full justification is harder for older eyes to read than for a left justification. So we don't generally want to fully justify something if there's any chance that we're going to have elderly people looking at it. We also don't like to use all caps. I don't know if you've noticed, but they've started changing the signs here in College Station and Bryan, the street signs, to have to not have all capital letters. They started changing it to be, lowercase with the first of each word capitalized, because that's easier also to distinguish when your eyes get older. Just a little heads up for you, if you're going to be doing this for anything other than your crazy says, we're going to go back to this page. We're going to add the CSS property to the H1 and footer styles for text align. And remember, we're going to try to be alphabetical unless they tell us otherwise. So here in the H1, we're going to say text align center. So we're going to put it back in the way it was before. And then we're going to go down to the footer. And we're going to say text align center, which I am so relieved because that footer looks dreadful. Now, did I get everything in there? Because I was talking so much, I could have easily made a mistake. And see how hideous this footer is? Ugh, it's just nasty. It's not lined up properly. It's a different size. It's just disgusting. So we're going to watch as our H1 is centered and as our footer is centered by F5, and there they are. So isn't that much nicer and neater? On page 172, the text talks about removing the underlines on links. The underlines on links are called text decorations. So we use the text decoration property and then the value. The values for text decoration property are none, underline, or line through. And it's become common, it's become best practice in web design to not have all your links underlined. To actually, when you mouse over them, to have them change. And that's another thing that we'll, another command we'll look at, another property we'll look at. But in the meantime, we're going to take out those underlines for our links. And so that on our style sheet would be A, is where our links are defined. I'm going to come down here. And we're going to add text decoration none. Save. Come back here and let's look at what that looks like up here. See, it's much cleaner. Now when we mouse over it, nothing happens. We are going to learn how to do a hover effect so that it's more obvious when we have a link. But there is one thing that lets you know it's a link, and that is when you're, look at my mouse. My mouse is a little open triangle, open pointer. When I mouse over it, it turns into a finger pointer. So that's how you still know it's a link. But it's really not obvious enough. On page 174, after we've set the text decoration to none, we see that the person who hired us to do the job likes everything we've done, and she wants us to make the whole site like that, because look what happens. This is my index page, right? But look at this page. Ew. This page, ew. This page, ew. We're going to change all of those magically just by linking them. So come back to here, to our index page, grab that link, and copy it. So you put your mouse here, shift home, control C, and then we're going to put on the same page, place on each page. So right under the title, save, save, save. Obviously, we're not going to put it on this page. Now let's go back and see what happens. When I refresh this page, gorgeous! And all of the pages are now refreshed and beautiful. We have a nice theme for our site, don't we? So this is why we use CSS. Now you get it. Why did I have to learn two different languages in 4 weeks? Well, now you get it. So, you're going to validate this. And then you're going to zip and submit your files. So congratulations on another job well done,